Hi everyone, welcome to Frankie the Wine Man. I'm Felix Taverna. This is Frankie the Wine Man. Frankie, nice to have you here.
A pleasure and honor. Thank you for inviting me.
Share with us a little bit about your background, how you became so involved and love the games of wines.
As a matter of fact, today we have a Malbec. It's a grape that is grown wildly in Argentina. So I went to Argentina to taste the Malbec from Mendoza, and that really stole my heart and became an obsession.
Tell us about the different regions of wines and what are the most prominent right now. I'm sure Italy, France, even the United States probably have great wines, correct?
Correcto mundo. So let's talk about the old world, Europe. The top three, Italy, France, and Spain. If we go to the new world, United States, Australia, New Zealand, every country that really is between the 30th and the 50th latitude and equator and 30 and 50, they can grow wine. So the knowledge and the possibility are endless.
What about the grapes? Share with us about how many different types of grapes there are.
Over 5,000 grapes, because nature dictates our future and our faith. Sometimes we have clones, sometimes we have hybrids, sometimes we have crosses, sometimes we have mutations, and some of them are man-made. So the list grows and grows. There's more than 5,000 grapes in our plant.
What is the one thing that you love about wines that you have learned that it's ever changing?
Wine is made by humans. So wine reflects humanity. And you learn history, geography, chemistry, botany, and enjoying a wine with the person that you want to really enjoy it. Could be a relative, could be a friend, it could be your significant other. In my book, that's priceless.
So when we talk about the grapes, you shared with us there's over 5,000 grapes?
Correct.
So are they all man-made grapes or synthetic grapes? I mean, we have marijuana that's synthetic right now. What about the grapes?
In this case, 90% are nature-made.
So tell me about some of your favorite wines.
The one that really stole my heart before I went to Argentina was Pinot Noir, the one that is grown in Burgundy. It's one of the best Pinot Noir that I ever tasted. And I fell in love, and I had the ability to go and travel and taste some of the native wines of that specific country.
I was researching where, like, there's wines that have been auctioned off for millions of dollars.
Correct.
And what is that based on? Is that based on the grape, the soil, or the company and the winery?
How is demand and supply, first of all. Second, the history and the prestige. Third, who drank that wine before, okay? It was maybe a king, a duke, or a celebrity, and made it famous. And so there's a lot about intricates that really, that a person that wants to have that bottle, it will go to the max, okay? In the auction, a million, 2 million.
So you have a variety of wines. You have Cabernets, Chardonnays, Pinot Noir, as you mentioned. What are some of the others?
Well, guess what? From Chardonnay all the way down to Gamay, from Nebbiolo all the way to Aglianico. So every single region, they have their native grapes. Let's go to Campania, Italy. Very simple. You have Falanghina, you have Falanghina, and you have another one, it's called Fieno di Avellino. Those are native grapes from that specific region. They reflect their terroir, the soil, their people, the climate. Irrigation system. So it's like every single grape has a recipe.
Price is very important. There's some good wines for $25?
Yes, indeed.
$50?
Yes, indeed.
Is there any difference between $50 and $150 bottles of wine?
Yes, but you need to know the producer.
What's the difference?
The difference is maybe how much that wine was aged. It could be aged in American oak. It could be maybe this winemaker is world famous because he's been having and making wine for the last 50 years. So he created fame and prestige. And there is like a cult. People follow him. Like a cult. So yeah, all that using marketing tools, the social media, and everything that we have available in the internet, those prices can skyrocket. Or right now, we have a fire in Napa. Those wines, okay, they're gonna be in demand and the price is gonna be double and triple.
Yeah, that's a very unfortunate up there in wine country in Napa, California. When we talk about wines, I want to ask you, what's your favorite, red or white?
As a sommelier, I taste everything that I can reach, but I'm a red guy. From Pinot to Malbec to Nebbiolo, okay? Very tannin, okay? Very pungent, very masculine. It's like they really suck the air out of your mouth. That's my preference, that's my palate.
What'd you bring with you tonight?
Tonight we have a really awesome selection. The first one is Chardonnay. This is native from Burgundy, France. The second one is called Garnacha or Grenache. Wiley, native to Spain. And the third one, Malbec, is French, but Argentina made it famous. So we have one white and two reds.
Let's open up one of those reds. Oh, yeah. Huh?
It would be my pleasure.
So we're here at Rusty Cucina, 3797 Park Boulevard, one of the up-and-coming new restaurants, when I happened to meet Frankie the Wine Man here. And his experience in wine is so unlimited in regard to knowing everything about, you know, the process of how they grow the wine, or they grow the grapes, and then they make the wines and they get it to your table. And with a lot going on with this pandemic, I'm sure a lot of people are sitting at home drinking a lot more wine than they used to be during the quarantine. But we were sitting here about a month ago, and they're on Park Boulevard here in San Diego, and we were talking about wine, and these two beautiful ladies walked by and started talking about wine with Frankie, and Frankie had an immediate love affair teaching them about wines. And Frankie, is there any truth that women love wine more than men?
Yes, indeed.
Why?
Let me tell you why. As a sommelier, I have to build my palate. I have to train my palate. And I have, as a man, by DNA, we have less taste buds. Women, they have twice as much. So, plus they cook, they're shopping. So they're around herbs, vegetables. So, and they're more keen on savoring and tasting. They can smell the sage, and I have to smell it and say, let me see if I can get the sage. Because their DNA, they're blessed by evolution. Us, we have to fight. We don't have time to drink. They're in the kitchen, raising the kids, making meals. So they really, through evolution, through our time, they develop better taste buds.
I gotta ask you, Frankie, what's the bling bling that you're wearing around your neck?
A lot of my friends, they think it's an ashtray, okay? Like a Flavor Flav, but it's not. It's called the Taste du Bon. And in French means the wine taster.
And so you taste wine out of that?
Yes, every single sommelier, when you pass the course, is given to you. So this is our symbol, our sommelier symbol. It's like our kind of a holy grail.
Tell us about the wine you opened.
This Chardonnay is from South Australia. This vineyard has been around from 1850. And I had it many, many times. And the winemaker, his name is Paddy Devlin. And he's very consistent. Consistency in the wine is something that's very hard to do, because every year you have different climate conditions. The soil could be depleted. There's a lot of factors involved. So I'm gonna really assess the wine for you guys. So first thing I'm gonna do, I get the glass eye level, and I'm looking right now for that is clean, looks bright. I will put my finger underneath. Usually, if it's a red wine, it's hard to see your finger, so that tells me that has a lot of density. This one is a white wine, so I can see my finger. Now what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna swirl.
Why do they do that?
Because now we're gonna really create a chemical reaction with air. And now, as soon as I really mix air with the wine, those aromas are gonna explode.
So you're saying there's chemistry involved here?
There's chemistry, still chemistry today, inside the bottle.
So when people, what do they call it?
We call them swirl.
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 So they swirl it because of what?
Because we need to really make sure that the air has full contact with the juice. Or the wine.
Now, is there more swirl versus white versus red?
No, it's the same.
Same swirl.
You will see me doing the same process to every single wine I taste.
Do you have to practice your swirl at all? I mean, you get in front of the mirror, and like before you go out into these big events, do you swirl?
And that's why I pour a little bit so I can do the swirl, so I don't spill it. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna really get my nose at the center. Sometimes I get my nose and I prod my nose through the skin of the glass. I can smell cantaloupe, melon, vanilla. That tells me that this wine was aged in American oak. Now what I'm gonna do?
Any money in there at all?
We can make some money. So what I like to do, I like to tilt and rock the glass and stand it up, and I will see the legs. If those legs are very, very thick, means a lot of viscosity and high alcohol. If the legs runs very fast and thin, the opposite. Less alcohol, less viscosity. Now I'm gonna really taste it, and it's a little bit different the way that we do it, okay? What I did, I took a sip. In the same moment that I took a sip, I did the slurpee from 7-Eleven. Means I really intake some air, I'm creating a chemical reaction. I close my mouth, I do the swirl, east to west, north to south. I just bathe my mouth inside the wine. Later, I swallow it, and when I feel the last drop, I exhale through the nose, and I keep my mouth shut.
So what would you pair that with, Frankie?
This one over here, I would like to really pair with pork.
Pork. What kind of pork?
Oh, just like a carnitas, okay? Like a Mexican,
yeah, really?
Carnitas, yeah. Mm-hmm. And less kind of a mild season, and you can see the white meat. That's what I like to do.
About fish?
Fish is a good option.
Yep.
I like to try something a little bit different, like pork and poultry, chicken. Fish will be the first answer. Like a sole fish. We'll go with.
So how productive has the wine industry been over the last 5 years in regards to creating new types of wines? And is there any one country that's reigning supremacy over the wine industry right now?
Matter of fact, let's go to Europe, because that's the old country. I'm half Italian, so 1 year, Italy's number one, and the next year, France is number one. So those two, the battle. The third one, always bronze medal, is Spain. Now, the people, we travel more. We have more interaction with the internet. The information is just in our face. So those winemakers, they really interact between each other. They're called flying winemakers. And they from country to country, and they change knowledge, and they share the knowledge. So now the wine industry, right now it's booming, especially to the tourists. For tourism development.
What are the upcoming countries that are producing wines that are starting to cut the gap?
Let's go to the East Bloc. Bulgaria. Oh, they're making awesome Pinot Noir.
And why is that?
Because right now, they were under the rule of the Soviet Union. It took them years to really change their mindset. And now they can really exchange and market with another country.
The soil there?
The soil is outstanding.
The grapes?
Pinot Noir. Right now, they're making awesome Pinot Noir.
Bulgaria is one. Who's number two?
Romania.
Romania is up on the upswing.
So right now, the East Bloc, they used to really belong to the Soviet Union. They're waking themselves. Okay, yes, we were under the regime of being what subdued. Now, freedom is coming out. And they're traveling, and they're going to different universities. So they're learning from the old way to the new ways.
What about Australia?
Australia has been a vanguard. Matter of fact, this wine is from South Australia. And Australia always been a vanguard.
Mm-hmm. So, can I see that?
Oh, yes indeed.
And so, tell me, you hold it, and it's a Devlin's?
Devlin's, yeah, Mount.
Mount, Chardonnay. And how much would that bottle of wine sell for?
Fluctuate between $12 to $15.
And that is a great bottle of wine?
Yes, sometimes the cost of the wine doesn't really give you the quality. So you have to taste them and find out, you know something? I get more bang for my buck.
How did you learn about this type of wine?
I went to a supermarket, and it was the only bottle. It was in bottles. And because it was the only bottle, I grabbed it. And I find myself, after I drank it, I found a gem. Between $12 to $15 depends on the retail.
And everybody's looking for a bargain, a great bottle of wine. You can buy a great bottle of wine for under $25, then you're saying.
Very good, yeah.
Yep. And what about these other two, Frank?
Oh, very good. The Delinquent, that's going to be the next one, the Garnacha, fluctuated between 15 to 18.
And let's bring that show to the people. You can put that back. bring the next one that you that you say.
Yeah, over here. And the grapes called Garnacha, and in English we call them Grenache.
And how did you discover this bottle?
This one did my research. This wine is vinified in one of the oldest vineyards in Spain. It's called Campo de Borja. They've been around from 1145. One more time, to date back 1145. Matter of fact, they are the leftovers from the Roman Empire. And when I read the story, I say I need to have it. Okay, the first one I had to order it online, and now Bethel they have it.
All right, we're gonna close this Frankie the Wine Man segment. We are live in San Diego in the heart of Hillcrest. We're at Rusty Cucina. All kinds of action going on outside. And it's a very beautiful summer night, a perfect night to open up a bottle of wine. Share with us five bottles of wine that are reasonably priced and could be someone's next purchase when they go to the wine cellars or the wine stores or the liquor stores. Give us five.
The first one that I'm going to really mention is from Portugal. It's called Lagos, or Lagos, if you want to say it in English. And it's a blend of five Portuguese grapes. Awesome price, $7.99.
Lago. All right, okay. Number two would be?
Number two will be a blend from the Rhone Valley. It's called Val Reyes. And you can get it in Trader Joe's, okay? And usually, this price between $8 to $9.
Wow. Why so inexpensive?
Because what they do is they buy by bulk, okay? This is the reason why. Let's suppose that you're a winemaker and you made wine last year, but you have not been lucky to sell all of them. Now you need to have the storage space because now you're gonna be making the new harvest. So it's hard for you to buy another storage because it costs money. So what they do, they discount the wine and they made their money. They get the money back, a little bit of profit, but they need the space so they can really have the next wave of wine. So that's why it's affordable.
So we're at number two, three more to go.
Pinot Noir.
Pinot Noir.
And Pinot Noir is one of those called, I think it's called Umami, okay? And depends on that. That was for Bulgaria, okay? Outstanding, outstanding wine. And I got it from Grocery Outlet, believe it or not.
So this is the wine from Bulgaria?
Bulgaria.
And it's a Pinot Noir?
Pinot Noir.
And it's one of the best you've had?
How much? Price and quality ratio. Price and quality ratio.
How much?
$6.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
I go across the board.
Okay.
I take all of them.
Give us the final two. Give us a nice $25 bottle of wine.
Mm-hmm. Okay, if we can really get on time and become a wine member, this one is called Eagle Nest, and that one is made in Ramona. They make outstanding Cabernet Sauvignon
right here in San Diego.
In San Diego.
And what's the name of it again?
Eagle Nest. And they just sold it.
It's a red or a white?
It's a red.
It's a red wine. And they sold the winery?
They sold the winery about maybe 2 weeks ago.
Really?
Eagle Nest.
So yeah. Will somebody continue to produce under that banner?
To be honest with you, I don't have the whole enchilada.
Right.
But I know a good friend of mine that is a wine club member, and he buys the wine, he buys cases. And he gave me a bottle. And every time that I taste it, it's one of those little gems that we have here in San Diego, in our own count, Ramona.
You know, you say they buy cases, and then there are wine storage places right now where people buy cases of wine and then they store them in.
Correct.
A designated, what's it called?
Temperature control wine storage. And usually you store it at a specific temperature between 55 to 57 degrees Fahrenheit. That's the window. Doesn't matter, white or red.
And what's your last $25 bottle of wine that you can share with us?
It's for Portugal, okay?
Portugal.
It's from Portugal.
From Ramona, California to Portugal.
Correct. And okay. It is a red blend. It's called Portugalia. And Portugal is the name of Portugal back in the Roman times. And it's five different grapes and all of them are red. And the value is $11, $12, insanely out of your mind. It was gonna blow your socks off.
So are we going to be looking for some great wines in this next season? When is wine season? Like, I'm in a horse racing game, and breeding season is in January, February, March. When is the prime season for wine?
So here we go. Let's start from harvest. Usually harvest starts September, October, November. Depends on the grape. Because they're really the ripe. They have different ripening time. So by December, those wine, those rootstocks or vines, they go to sleep. Because already we did the picking of the grapes. Now the winemaker is going to really start making the wine. January, February, March. Now by March and April, now we start the next season.
Wow.
Okay. Now we start planting, we start pruning, and now we're getting ready for the next season that will be start from March, April, and from there you will see the berries growing by May. By June, you're gonna have the change of color. If it's red wine, the grape is green, it starts changing to red. It's called a verizon. So being a winemaker, you have to be a chemist, a farmer, a winemaker, an insane person, because you did the harvest, that doesn't mean that you're done. You have to do the upkeep for the next cycle.
And to know all about these wines, you got to know Frankie the Wine Man. First episode here, we're live from Rustic Cucina in San Diego in the heart of Hillcrest, and just a great summer evening with Frankie the Wine Man. One final question, you want to shout out to anybody from your native Puerto Rico?
Matter of fact, I'm blessed. My dad was Italian, my mother's Puerto Rican, I was born in Jersey. I grew up in different countries. I ended up in San Diego, and from here, I went to UC Davis. I went to San Diego State, and
with degrees,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. UC Davis degree.
And you got a degree in winemaking too. You're a PhD in winemaking. In Spanish, I know your brother is in Puerto Rico. You want to shout out to him in Spanish and wish him well.
Mm-hmm. Hermano, cuídate. Estás pasando por un momento muy difícil, pero de corazón te extraño y te quiero.
Frankie, thanks for joining us. Episode number one, a wrap from Rustic Cucina here, 3797 in the heart of Hillcrest, one of the up-and-coming Italian restaurants. This is Frankie the Wine Man. Episode number one is a wrap. We'll see you next time on Frankie the Wine Man.
Ciao. Adios. Bye.